This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised.
So anyway, here's Quagmire walking through the park, minding his own business. I just happen to be there with my video camera when a ninja shows up! And then a Nazi came! And then a evil Pots and Pans robot! Destroy! Destroy! Oh no! Quagmire's dead! Wait, we might still be able to save it. Oh no! Dun 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 dun.
Hey guys, Sean Fay Wolf of Diamond X Studios here. I almost didn't make this video.
Yeah, I'm a turner. I turn pages all the time.
It's March of 2021. It is entirely too late to be doing a retrospective on the music of 2020. I'm aware of that. By this point, most people have mentally blocked off the wasted year that was 2020 and confined it to the far back of our mental filing cabinets. And the last thing we need to do now that we're nearly a quarter of the way into the new year is take one last look inside that compartment. Trust me, I, like many of you, never want to think about the year of 2020 again as long as I live. So why did I decide to make this video? Well, because I needed to create a record. Analyzing popular music is what I do. It's what I love. It's what I've devoted the past 3.5 years of my life to doing. And when I create a video, my goal is to create a snapshot of the era in focus, refracted through the lens of my own personal experiences and opinions. As tempted as I was to move on from 2020 the moment my best list was done, I knew deep down that I just wouldn't be satisfied until I had painted a full picture capturing my perspective on all the biggest hits from this year. I know that for many of you watching this, the pain of 2020 is still fresh, but when you view this video, try not to think of it as a trip down a painful memory lane, but instead as a record of what music the American people turned to help us through the worst year of our collective lives, viewed through the lens of one man's immediate hindsight. This was the year our Titanic sank, and the debris we chose to cling to in the frigid Atlantic waters is quite telling as to the type of people we are, so let's take a look at it. Without further ado, it's my great honor to present to you my last video for the worst year. Let's make it count.
My diamonds be VV. They don't wanna see us on TV unless it's the news. I got something to prove. Yeah, I'm young, but got something to lose. In the street, I done paid out my dues. No extortion, ain't talking about literally. I be walking on BCs, you hearing me? I just pray that my kids be a bigger me. They can't get rid of me.
Oh, and by the way, the title of this video is a lie. I'm actually going to be talking about both the Billboard and Rolling Stone year-end lists in this one video, which means I'm actually going to be talking about 118 songs, not 100. Let's go.
Every time I take a break, the game be so boring. Pretty like Naomi, Cassie plus Lorman.
Just like in my worst list, I have to clarify that yes, the original version of this song is perfectly fine, but the Nicki Minaj remix is what got the song to number one. And that remix was so definitional to the worst aspects of pop music this year that I have absolutely no hesitation in naming it one of the worst songs of the year. Not only is Nicki Minaj a really shitty and sensitive person who's not afraid to inject those qualities into her music, and not only does her verse itself slice the song into a bunch of unrelated sections that clash horribly and don't complement each other at all, but this remix and the push by Nicki and her fans to get it to number one was emblematic of why I started caring so much less about the pop charts in 2020. I follow the pop charts because I find it enjoyable to analyze rising and falling trends and what the public is seeking out, and that's simply not possible when fan armies buy hundreds of thousands of copies in 1 week to get their fave a number one hit, and then immediately forget the song afterwards because they don't really care about the music, just about getting more gold medals than the other girls. When fan armies pull shit like that, they're basically just driving a car to the top of a mountain just to buy a bumper sticker at the gift shop there saying that they conquered it. It's vapid, it's disingenuous, it's meaningless, and it cheapens the experience for everyone else who did it legitimately. I know that's a lot of baggage to pin on this remix specifically, but hey, it also sounds like total ass, so yeah, worst hit of the year.
I'm stuck with you, stuck with you, stuck with you.
Enough
A lot of people told me that I was being too harsh on this song because it came out in the early pandemic before it was clear that we were in this for the long haul, and that Ari and Bieber were just telling people to take a deep breath and try and appreciate what they do have. And to that I say, A, I don't want to hear one percenters bragging about how carefree and secure they are even when we're not in the middle of a global pandemic, and B,
I'ma get to know you better. Kinda hope we're here forever. If you told me that the world's ending, ain't no other way that I can spend it. I can stay here forever. We got all that we need here tonight. You are picture perfect, you don't need no filter.
This song makes me feel like I'm drinking Diet Sprite Zero while listening to an interview with a vapid suburban soccer mom through a radio with a bad connection in the middle of start and stop traffic while I'm carsick. I rack my brain to try and see if there were any other pop songs I could think of that made me feel this exact combination of nausea, irritation, emptiness, and commercialized cheapness, and I could only think of one.
Thunder.
Thunder.
So yeah, make of that what you will.
Why you gotta be so heartless? I know you think it's harmless.
Honestly, I'm surprised the people waited for Morgan Wallen to shout the N-word in a drunken rage to cancel him. I mean, this song has been out for a year and a half now, people.
Fall for me. I wanna know you feel how I feel for you, love.
Does anyone else realize that this dude is basically just the James Blunt of 2020?
You're beautiful. You're beautiful.
I mean, think about it. A random white dude who looks like an early 2000 stock photo comes out of nowhere with a smash hit that's both uniquely obnoxious and yet still suffocatingly of the moment, complete with shitty grammar and weird gargling of vowels, and no one's ever gonna hear from him again. All we need to do is get Trevor Daniel to hit me up on Twitter and we've got a perfect match.
Why won't you die?
Prince, has this ever worked?
Till I'm late at night, holding someone new, still chasing you.
Just a reminder that I disliked this Morgan Wallen song before disliking Morgan Wallen songs was cool.
But if the world was ending, you'd come over, right? You'd come over and you'd stay the night.
Hey, remember when I said this song was like a cross between We Don't Talk Anymore and If I Die Young, perfectly blending the boring shared experience duet with the morbid, self-important teenage death wish fantasy? Well, I just thought of another thing this song reminds me of.
So I'm gonna love you like I'm gonna lose you.
Yeah, remember that song where Megan Legend and John Trainor sing about how she had a bad dream that he disappeared, but now she's awake and he's still there, so they're just gonna continue existing? Yeah, that's the same energy I get from a love song centered around an earthquake where one of you didn't feel it and the other one didn't care.
I was distracted and in traffic. I didn't feel it when the earthquake happened.
It didn't scare me when the earthquake happened.
I hope you come from on your ex, every one of your friends. I hope you spend your last time to put a rock on her head.
Okay, we all know why the Charlie Puth remix of this song is shit. I'm not gonna harp on that. But I am gonna defend the original for a second here, because frankly, I think it gets a bum rap. I've heard a lot of people say this song doesn't work because it's a song about wanting revenge instead of getting revenge, where Gabby just lists off all these things she wants to happen to this guy without taking any action, and that's a really flimsy and lame premise for a song. But here's what I haven't seen anyone talking about. The song itself is the revenge. Gabby's not fantasizing about all the things she wants to happen to this guy and just inventing them from full cloth. No, she's listing out all of the things that he did to her. She's laying out every single shitty thing this dude did to her in public in the most spiteful, passive-aggressive way imaginable and getting the entire country to sing along with it. The quote-unquote revenge is that all the details of what a scumbag this dude is are now etched in stone in one of the biggest country songs of all time. And personally, I think that's pretty damn effective.
I'm the only one of me. Baby, that's the fun of me.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum, that yummy, yummy.
It seems that after 4 years of Donald Trump, people are now more cognizant than ever of the power that words hold. And we're taking this newfound awareness to look back and reevaluate a lot of the people and targets we collectively pigpiled on at the beginning of the decade. Frankly, I'm really glad that we all seem to have come to an agreement that we were all way, way too hard on the young Justin Bieber, and that he didn't deserve all the hate just for being a teen idol back then. In actuality, he deserves all of that hate now for being a boring, lame musician whose failures are plentiful and whose successes are accidental. accidental.
I don't wanna ruin this one. This type of love don't always come and go.
I genuinely feel bad for putting this song lower on the list than so many songs that I have so much less respect for artistically, but I'm sorry. If a song has me constantly wanting to re-listen to it, only for me to bail before the halfway mark every time I try, that disappointment sticks with me more than some lame-ass shit that never even had a chance. Everything Juice WRLD does on this song is amazing, and I can't tell you how badly I want to love it, but, well, you know.
Marshmello sucks.
I'd spend 10,000 hours and 10,000 more.
You know, at the rate the vaccine rollout is going, it's looking like 10,000 hours will be almost exactly the average length of the lockdown for a typical American. Imagine Justin Bieber making this face at you every waking moment of the lockdown, and you'll know what listening to this song feels like to me.
Savage love, did somebody break your heart?
I don't think we've fully processed how funny it is that in the 12 years he's been in the music industry, Jason Derulo's only two number one hits are just him grabbing the biggest meme he can get his hands on and stamping OC Do Not Steal on them.
I needed to hate you to love me.
Joshua Bassett's gonna get his first number one hit in 2032, singing about what a terrible girlfriend Olivia Rodrigo was, mark my words.
But mama party girl, she just wanna have fun too.
Yep, this was the party song that 2020 fucking deserved.
Take it out with, sling it out with.
You know, it's very rare that I dislike a song purely based on how disgustingly, graphically sexual the lyrics are, but...
I just put my cum in a plastic with.
Yeah, this sounds like the last sex jam the dudes made before the women took over.
You one of them girls that ain't handing out your number. You like to make us want you.
One of them girls is a prime example of how production and tone can affect the way a song comes across. Because lyrically speaking, this song is every bit as pushy and uncomfortable as Take Your Time by Sam Hunt, but nobody really seemed to mind because it sounded so upbeat and fun. I will say that I completely understand why so many people enjoy this, but Take Your Time by Sam Hunt is one of the worst songs of the past decade, so if we could please stop making songs with even a passing resemblance to it, that'd be just peachy.
Stick a right foot up, left foot slide.
Honestly, I kind of feel this one, not gonna lie. It's on the edge of being a guilty pleasure for me. I was gonna be nice and call it meh, but I kept it down here because there is no hit from this year that I respect less than 2C Slide. I don't respect Drake for making it, I don't respect all those celebrities and influencers on TikTok for promoting it, and I don't respect the general public for taking the bait and making this huge. Drake led us to a field of AstroTurf and commanded us to graze, and we obeyed without question, leaving a 5-star review of the pasture on Cow Yelp for good measure. There is entirely too much Drake in the universe, and frankly, I'm more than ready for him to burn himself out any day now.
Through the Cooper 17, no guidance.
I repeat, any day now.
I did some wrong, but I'm always right. I know how to shoot.
Hey, remember that time Lil Baby and DaBaby working together was a meme, you know, a dumb joke that they were both in on, and then they did it again and the American public decided to turn it into a dead man's most successful song?
I wish I never met your ass. Sometimes it'd be like that.
Nerd!
I'ma need some whiskey glasses if I'm gonna make it through.
Yeah, I don't think you're gonna make it through, buddy.
We party to the extremo, 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 extremo.
Ritmo. If you had asked me what the most likely way the Black Eyed Peas would be able to get back onto the pop charts, I don't know if I could have given you a better answer than making the theme song to the highest grossing movie of the year where all the movie theaters got shut down.
I love you, baby, and I'm just quite alright.
This song is enjoyable for the length of one TikTok and not 1 second longer than that, so I should be annoyed that the entire 3-minute song is what wound up on the year-end list, but frankly, I think I'm more upset that the My Eyes Adored You guy is still relevant 50 years after the fact.
I love you, baby, and if it's quite alright, I need you, baby, to warm the lonely night.
But I'm in.
This is just a straight-up Florida Georgia Line song. And above-average Florida Georgia Line song, to be fair, but still.
Deep in the sky, does it ever get lonely?
Apparently, Jason Aldean is a massive scumbag who abandoned his wife and two kids for the girl he was cheating with. And this song is about how he has no regrets and he would do the exact same thing again if given the opportunity.
Ain't no second thoughts, no regrets, no kind of maybe.
I just thought this was a cute little song about calmly easing your partner's insecurities. And divorced from all context, I guess it still works as that, but... saying anything good about this song just feels gross now. I was originally going to end this bit by throwing a dart at a board with Jason Aldean's face on it, but then I realized that that would probably get my channel deleted, so... Jason Aldean sucks.
Bitches calling my phone like I'm locked up nonstop.
Just imagine going back to 2010 and telling people that a decade later, the All I Do Is Win guy and Lil Wayne's promising new upstart would be trying to enhance the song's coolness by giving it a music video where Justin Bieber throws a pajama party.
What you know about us?
I mean, not much if I'm being honest.
Something's in my living room, slave to the way you move hurts when I'm leaving you.
According to Billboard, more people were listening to Only Human than Dior in 2020. I'm not sure who, but somebody deserves to get slapped.
Who you with? Who? She like on that gangsta shit. I said she like on that gangsta shit.
She wanna fuck with the wolves. She wanna fuck with the wolves.
There's no song on the year end list that I have a harder time getting my head around than this one. So, Pop Smoke was a huge 50 Cent fan, and 50 Cent himself agreed to executive produce the album after Pop Smoke died. And for the one song that 50 decided to cameo on, not only did he put Pop Smoke in a different key for no reason, not only did he pick out the snippet of audio where Pop Smoke is doing a distressingly accurate 50 Cent impression, meaning their two verses sound exactly the same and Roddy's part sticks out like a sore thumb, but he also somehow managed to turn it into a ripoff of Friends by Marshmello and Anne Marie?
My kind of bitch, she be saying some shit like when you gon' fly me in private so I can land on that dick.
Don't mess it up. Talking that shit, only gonna push me away, that's it.
I mean, I don't dislike this song per se. I don't really have any opinion on it. It's just too peculiar for words one woo or the other.
Ha, I needed some shit with some boppy.
Let's go! Man, this da boppy song sure does exist, doesn't it?
When I dream of dying, I never feel so alive.
This song would probably be 40 spots higher on this list if it weren't for that whistling. Really neat idea in concept and construction, not something I've ever once gone out of my way to listen to in practice. Every big hit that carried over from 2019 into the new year felt weird to see on the pandemic-defined 2020 charts to some degree or another, but this was one of the weirdest. The week that Senorita debuted on the Hot 100, we were still talking about how disappointing it was that Big Ol' Freak was flopping and Megan Thee Stallion had missed her chance at becoming a superstar. And talking about this song now as an example of one of the biggest and most relevant songs of the year of the pandemic is messing with my fundamental understanding of reality.
I'm a savage. Yeah. Classy, bougie, ratchet.
Oh, yeah, and on the subject of the Big Ol' Freak woman, yeah, this one shrunk on me pretty hard over the course of the year. As bizarre as it might seem, I think this remix is the best example I've ever seen of too much of a good thing. The original song is fantastic, all of Beyoncé's additions are interesting and well-chosen, and it blends together wonderfully, but the production is just so overstuffed. It seems like Beyoncé is trying to cram in as many ad-libs as possible and make sure the spotlight is never more than a few inches away from her the whole time. Stretch that out to an excruciating 4-minute runtime, and you've got yourself an exhausting listening experience. This is another What's Poppin' situation, where the original was perfect for what it is. You don't need to turn it into a real song.
First turn, nigga from the hood, they curious. Four and cry about five and jury. I get the comments with none of this period.
I thought this song was absolutely incredible the first time I heard it, and I'm still waiting to hear what I heard in it that first time again, because good lord is this song dull if you're not feeling it. Wake me up if Joe and Kamala decide to sing this song from the White House roof as they finally hand out those stimulus checks.
Bang, bang, into the room. I know you want it. Bang, bang, all over you. I'll let you have it.
Your love is suicidal. For me, your love.
drunk and suicidal.
I'm sure that one day YNW Melly will get a hit that doesn't make me horribly uncomfortable to discuss, but as of now, his two hits consist of one song where he describes a real-life murder he committed in excruciating detail, and another where he teams up with a dead man on a song called Suicidal. This was not an exploit, for the record. The leaked audio of the finished version of the remix was circulating well before Jared's death, but that only makes it slightly less uncomfortable. Putting all that baggage aside, though, the song itself is fine. I know I've been really harsh on lyrics that connect suicide and relationships before, but I think it works on this one because Melly frames it as his own problem for getting overly attached. He's the one who walks out of it looking pathetic, and I'm pretty sure he knows it. Unfortunately, this same fact means that I do prefer the original to the remix. The whole vibe of wallowing in self-loathing is a lot easier to stomach from a song with only one person on it.
Gobble me, swallow me, drip down inside of me, quit, yeah. Jump out for you, let it get inside of me.
I still prefer body, but this'll do in a pinch.
I still see your shadows in my room.
Now that I'm counting the Rolling Stone year end for this list, and the Rolling Stone charts don't have any recurrency rules, I've got a hunch that this isn't gonna be the last year end list I talk about this song on. And I have a feeling that every time I talk about it, it's gonna be a little higher.
She filled my mind up with ideas. I'm the highest in the room.
The fact that Sicko Mode is now just one quarter of the total weeks that Travis Scott has spent at number one is not worth this song existing.
Yeah. None of you guys can flash me.
If you could see it from the front, wait till you see it from the back.
This song is kind of similar to Falling by Trevor Daniel in that I have absolutely no idea what situation one would have to be in to be compelled to listen to this song, but unlike Falling, I'm pretty sure that situation does in fact exist out there somewhere, so I'll take it.
Huh? What? I thought a bro nigga said something. Talking shit, but they still ain't saying nothing.
Excuse me, sir, has there ever been a robbery at this establishment?
Not that I know of. I don't know.
Every time I talk about this song, it ends up being way better than I remember it. But I always remember it being really boring and lame, so that really isn't saying much.
I don't wanna go down any other road now. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
I don't know enough about Blake Shelton and Gwen Stefani to make any judgments on their chemistry, and after listening to this song, I somehow feel like I know even less about the two of them than when I started. I don't really detect any of the anti-charisma I've heard so much about, but then again, they did make an entire Super Bowl commercial about how little sense the two of them make as a couple, so I'll just assume that I would have noticed the mismatch if they hadn't mixed Gwen's vocals so damn low.
Fuck a princess, I'm a king. Bow down and kiss on my ring. Being a bitch is my kink.
Cause I can't love you more than my hometown.
Look, on a serious note, it seems like Morgan Wallen was genuinely remorseful for all the stupid shit he's done, even before Nashville pulled their support for him. If he stays on this path, I think there's a good chance that a day will come where we'll find it in our hearts to forgive him and let him back into the country scene. And when we do, the only thing that's gonna hold him back is the fact that he sounds like Eddie Vedder doing a drunken impression of Billy Ray Cyrus.
See, the sky ain't the same black. Ain't that a map, dog? Shame and to think that.
What's poppin'? Brand new whip, just hopped in. I got options.
This remix has grown on me a lot over time, to the point where I honestly find myself seeking it out more than the original, even if I do support the original more in concept. That said, I am careful to always listen to it through an unofficial YouTube upload, because I'm not giving them my money. It's honestly kind of amazing. Jack Harlow got his pick of all the A-list star power he could have possibly wanted for this remix, and he still wound up featuring a terrifying monster of a human being with neither integrity nor self-awareness who's rampaging through the country. Oh, and Tory Lanez and Lil Wayne are there too, I guess.
Trying to love me, but they never get a pulse down. Cause I'm heartless.
Hey, remember that time this song set the record for the biggest drop off the number one spot, and then within a year drops that size and basically become the standard for big name debuts? I guess that's just another of the many rules of pop music rewritten by The Weeknd in 2020. I maintain that Heartless has all the elements it needs to be an A-plus song, but there's still a weird disconnect between Abel's vocals and Metro Boomin's production that I can't quite put my finger on, but can't quite look past. This song's quality is basically one of those squiggly lines that floats on the surface of your eye that moves farther away the more you try to focus on it.
Long neck, eyes, cold beer, never broke my heart.
If there's there's one thing I've learned from following the Rolling Stone charts, it's that country music is apparently way, way more popular than Billboard gives it credit for.
They say he likes a good time.
Why the hell do people hate this one again? I mean, granted, it is basically just Havana with all the lyrics replaced with something Camila probably wrote on Wattpad in 2012, but Havana's good, so what's the problem here?
It goes like one margarita, two margarita, three margarita shot.
I completely understand why a lot of people resent the fact that a song about Luke Bryan being a drunken, hedonistic beach bum got huge while people in the real world were being ravaged by a global pandemic. Ironically enough, I probably would have hated this if it had come out in 2019, but I'm not gonna lie to you, the fantasy of being a drunken, hedonistic beach bum sounded pretty damn good in this isolated hellscape, and I admit it, this song put a big, stupid smile on my face every time I heard it. I definitely have a soft spot for this one, though I'm not going to call it any better than decent, because, I mean, come on, I don't have no standards.
I got what you need. Everybody think you shy, but I know you a freak, little baby.
There are a lot of words I would use to describe this, man. Freaky is not one of them.
Don't not think. Moving too fast, candy paint with the windows all black.
This song doesn't seem particularly memorable or catchy, but I swear, just one listen and that chorus will be embedded in your brain until the end of time. I would give you guys some background on this song, but I don't know anything about her and I don't have much to say about YG. So the only conclusion I'm left to draw is that there are entirely too many acronyms flying around right now.
And you want me to change? Fuck you!
Fuck you!
You know what? Black Bear may have won the hot girl battle, but I think we can all agree that Megan won the hot girl war. Maybe a couple good things did come out of 2020 after all. And if you'd like to check out some more of those good things, be sure to check out part 2 of this video, which should be going live in the next few days. If you enjoyed this video, I'd really appreciate it if you'd leave a like, hit subscribe, and click the bell for notifications of every new upload, and leave a comment about the video, the music of 2020, or anything else you want to say. Likes and comments are extremely important for the growth of my channel, and engaging with this video and showing your support is extremely helpful. And you know who else is extremely helpful? All of my lovely supporters on Patreon. For just $2 per main series video, you get to suggest and vote for any songs in the world you want me to talk about in the next episode of Grab Bag Reviews. The next episode of that is coming out in just a few weeks, so there's never been a better time to hop in and take part. $5 per video gets you access to my official Discord server, where we hang out, talk about music and tons of other stuff, and play Jackbox, Among Us, Smash Bros, Mario Kart, and more almost every night. $10 patrons get early access to my videos, even before they premiere, while $20 patrons get to personally select any song to get a guaranteed review in each episode of Grab Bag Reviews. I'm Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond X Studios. Like I said before, part 2 of this video should be coming out very soon, and until then, take care of yourself.
I was born to run, I don't belong to anyone.